Hi everyone, I'm Stephen Gong. In this video tutorial, we're going to show you how we make 3 electrode coin cells as of February 2022. This version works pretty well for both normal cycling and EIS measurements. Okay, now let's get right into it. We will be using 2032 coin cell parts for this assembly. In addition to the typical things you need in your glove box, there are a few more items you need to prepare. You will need at least one more extra separator because we will be using a minimum of 2 or a maximum of 4. You want to have a pair of tweezers, at least one with a tip that's hard plastic such as PEEK. It allows you to handle the lithium metal more delicately because the tip doesn't stick to lithium. You will also need to prepare a fine copper mesh, which we will use as the substrate for the reference electrode. Here we're using a non-woven mesh with a thickness of 10 micrometers. We punch them into 4mm diameter discs. Lastly, you will need a thin wire to make an electrical connection to the copper mesh. Here we are using a thin 316 stainless steel wire of 50 micrometer gauge, but you can also use 25 micrometer wires. We have to insulate this wire, so let's take a closer look at how to do that. The total length of the wire is about 40 millimeters, the center portion about 25 millimeters, which is about an inch, is insulated with Kapton. Using thinner Kapton later helps for the seal. Here we are using 30 micrometers, which includes the thickness of the PDMS adhesive. You can create a bunch of these, wash them in acetone and alcohol, and then dry them before bringing them into the glove box. If all of these parts are prepared, we're now ready to do the assembly. This assembly method places the positive cap on the bottom and works all the way up to the negative electrode. Before the assembly, we should shape the stainless steel wire into a convenient shape. One end of the exposed wire is going to contact the mesh inside the cell, and the other end is going to be outside the cell. We want to fold the end that will stay outside, and it will later help us prevent the reference wire from shorting the counter electrode. Here, one end of the wire is folded to the back of the insulation. If we flip this thing, you can see the wire. Also note that the fold is made on the insulation, not on the wire or at the boundary. Now we're ready to start the assembly. Place the positive electrode and then the separator. In this demo, we're doubling the separator, but feel free to adjust the separator thickness in a way that works best for you. Now it's time to place the stainless steel wire. We want the wire to be centered. At the same time, the exposed wire should sit inside the separator area with a comfortable margin. Keep in mind that we are trying to prevent the wire from touching the positive cap below. After positioning the wire, insert the gasket and press to keep it in place. Now we want to prevent the wire from moving around. To do that, try to make a fold on the wire right at the edge of the gasket. Ideally, the inside segment of the wire, the insulated part above, and the outside segment of the wire should all be aligned with each other. This doesn't have to be perfect, but the placement is going to be more stable if it is aligned better. Drop some electrolyte to wet the electrode and separator. This keeps those components in place while we proceed with the rest of the assembly. Keep in mind that the electrolyte will be continuously drawing from now on. Ideally, you don't want to spend too much time from now on, otherwise you might change the salt concentration of your electrolyte. Now grab the copper mesh and place it underneath the stainless steel wire, trying to keep it centered. The goal is to have the mesh close to the center so that it doesn't go outside of the electrode sheet area. More electrolyte can be added at this point, but be careful to not add too much. Otherwise, the mesh might float away from the desired position. Add separators to cover the mesh. As before, feel free to double the separator if you like. Now is the last chance to add any extra electrolyte if you are trying to make a flooded cell. You can see how all the components are placed. Actually, there is one mistake here that we didn't notice when we were filming. Notice that the insulation is covering the edge of the electrode sheet. This misplacement should have been avoided by placing the positive electrode slightly lower than how it has been placed in this picture. Now it's time to assemble the rest of the cell. Using the plastic tip tweezer, place the lithium metal on top of the separator. Then place the spacer. Notice that Jimmy is a bit nervous here, knowing that so many people are going to be critiquing his cell assembly skills. Now with the non-lithium metal tweezer, continue with the rest of the assembly. When you put on the negative cap, try to find the groove in the gasket on the side where you have placed the wiretap. Because we have intentionally flooded the cell, we have extra electrolyte being squeezed out from the cell. If this happens, you can wipe the excess electrolyte before you bring it to the crimper. Now slightly press the tap onto the cap now to help it stay in place. When loading the cell into the crimper, you have to be extra careful not to slide the components out of place. Notice that the tap is facing the door of the crimper. Grab the cell with two hands and slide the cell into the crimper. Now before we crimp the cell, we want to place some Kim wipes to prevent the tap from being cut or folded awkwardly and shorting the negative cap. Cut a Kim wipe into half, put one below the tap and the other above the tap. The top one will be able to gently press the tap in place. Because the tap is facing the door, even if we disturb the Kim wipe when closing the door, the Kim wipe does not get pushed into the wrong direction. Now you can go ahead and crimp the cell. Your Kim wipes will get cut during the crimping process. Make sure you clean your cell before we move to the last sealing process. First, you can use a dry Kim wipe to wipe away excess electrolyte from your cell. Next, you want to use a solvent to remove residue. Otherwise, you will corrode your cell holder and produce contact problems. It's also a safety hazard to have residual electrolyte left on your cell. This can be done either by using DMC in the glove box or by using acetone right after taking the cell out of the glove box. Rather than dunking your cell in the solvent, I recommend wetting a Kim wipe with solvent and then use that to wipe the electrolyte. This is because we are yet to complete the seal, so we don't want to introduce tiny amounts of solvent into the cell. Because of the tap, the gasket seal is not as good as a normal coin cell. To complete the seal, we are going to put epoxy near the tap of the gasket area. We found that this step is critical for prolonging the lifetime of the 3-electrode coin cell. Here, we are using a typical 2-part fast curing epoxy. Also, as long as you make this seal right after taking the cell out from the glove box, our tests showed that the lifetime was the same as curing the epoxy inside the glove box. Now it's time to load our cell into a holder. We made these adapters where you can plug in a normal 4-terminal coin cell holder and make it into a 6-terminal holder with an alligator clip for the extra electrode. Feel free to design your own holder that works best for you. Notice that we are loading the cell upside down so that the tap is more easily accessible. This means that you want to put the plastic spacer on the clip side when loading the cell. Now clip the reference electrode and you're ready to load the cell into your cycler. Remember that first you will want to plate lithium on the copper mesh before you can use it as a proper reference electrode. Okay, that concludes the assembly demo and I hope you have fun making 3-electrode coin cells. Bye bye.